This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for this program is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
Shannon, welcome to Local Color. This week at the Brooks, February the 11th, this is really cool. They're showing the Oscar-nominated shorts. This will be the 11th at the Brooks. The shorts include The Fantastic Flying Brooks of Mr. Morris Lesmore, La Luna, A Morning Stroll, and Wildlife. Also, Sunday, Diamante. I hope I didn't massacre any of those. But they're also showing, what is it they're showing on the 18th, Chris?
The live action shorts are on the 18th.
That is just such a cool concept. I love the idea that before we had a child, we used to actually watch as many of the Oscar nominees as we could. And now, you know, it seems to be more Pixar and Disney than anything else. But that's really cool. Y'all go check it out. Also, we've got Valentine's coming up.
We do. Valentine's Day is coming up, and it's kind of getting close. So if you've missed booking a reservation at your favorite restaurant, there are some fun things that you can really do to sort of treat your Valentine.
And get yourself out of hot water.
Exactly. Some of my suggestions are, you know, you don't have to go out on Valentine's Day. Plenty of restaurants are doing their Valentine's Day specials all week long. So just go to their website or your favorite restaurant and just see if, or their Facebook page and see if they have something fun going on. You know, I know we have it at the Majestic Grill. We're going to be running our specials all through the entire week. One of my favorite things, Jose Gutierrez from River Oaks says, champagne always shows you care. And that's one of my favorite things that he said.
I think it's unanimous here.
And I totally believe him and agree with him. So some great bubbles to buy. I know Joe's carries these. They carry a Mum Napa Rosé, which is delicious.
I love pink champagne.
Pink champagne is my favorite.
I love pink champagne.
Bouvet Rosé is my favorite. I absolutely love it.
What is it called?
Bouvet Rosé, or Criterre makes a great rosé. We've got Barefoot Rosé if your budget's a little bit smaller, but it's delicious. It's nice and dry. Or the Gloria Blanc de Noirs is delicious as well. So bubbly always works. You can always buy some local jewelry. Becca Bells has a beautiful collection at Lansky's 126 in the Peabody. It's gorgeous, very unique, one-of-a-kind pieces for your one-of-a-kind Valentine.
Supporting our local artists.
Exactly. Or one of my favorite things to do is breakfast in bed on Valentine's Day.
I love breakfast in bed.
It's great. This is an easy way to do it. You can go and get some local coffee. There's Jay Brooks Coffee Roasters at jaybrookscoffeeroasters.com. They have their coffee in various locations. You can get it at the Urban Farms Market. I think there's a couple other places that you can pick it up. It's delicious. It's a new local coffee maker. And pick up the night before. Go pick up some pastries from Cafe Eclectic. Their pastries are amazing. Put together a little platter and bring it in for your honey.
I love that. Have you guys heard about, well, you know, the Brushmark is doing lunch on Sunday. That will be on the 12th at 11 a.m. until 2:30 at the Brooks. But have you heard about Armor Mi Amore?
It's a tongue twister.
It's a tongue twister. Armor Mi Amore. Okay, you know the exhibit that's going on now, the Armed and Dangerous exhibit at the Brooks. This is such a cool idea. I love this. They're calling it Valentine's Remix. It's on the 16th of February. Couples start the evening with going on the tour and seeing the Armed and Dangerous exhibit. And then you go and enjoy a talk on Courtney Love and Chivalry that is presented by the University of Memphis medievalist and instructor Courtney Lockhart. Finally, the couples make a love token together under the guidance of someone from the Metal Museum. Doesn't that sound like fun?
I'm just glad to hear no one's actually shot by a bow.
But you know what?
Right. Well, it depends on what you make as your love token.
Exactly. There is a possibility that could be your love token.
I love that, too, though, because it's just hyper-local, and I love local Valentine's Day,
like
everything Denny was talking about. That's really fun.
I think so, too. And, you know, just be creative. Like you said, you don't have to go out and do the dinner and feel like you're stuffy, mm-hmm. you know, cater it to your needs and your desires and what you guys like.
Or fetishes, as this were too.
Well, I wasn't going to say that. Tell me about what's going on in the music world. I know there's a lot going on for Valentine's Day.
Absolutely. Minglewood is going to be doing a Valentine's All-Star Jam. That's on Saturday the 11th of February. So Will Tucker Band, Amy Jamison, a bunch of folks are going to be playing there. I think it starts around 6:30. So that's going to be a night of music on the 11th if you want to take your sweetheart out. And then there's actually a matinee show on Sunday at the High Tone. Jeffrey and the Pacemakers, British cover band, really fun. So okay. kind of a throwback feel. And that's from 4 to 7. So, I mean, that's good for your younger Valentines, too.
Well, now, Jeffrey and the Pacemakers is Memphis royalty. It's Robert Hall and Jeff Golightly. And I don't know who else is sitting in with them, but I'm sure it'll be fantastic.
It's going to be a lot of fun. And it's just nice to see something in the afternoon, too. And you can go and...
Yeah, you can take the kids.
Exactly.
It's, yeah. And those guys have been around in different incarnations for a long time.
And I mean, still are.
Jeff, I mean, The Crime was one of the original Antenna Club punk rock bands. It was Jeff Golightly's band. And not very long ago, I say not very long ago, it's been probably 2 years, I just happened to wander into Murphy's to catch a surprise reunion of The Crime.
No!
Oh, yeah. They were gearing up for one of the Antenna Club reunions. One of the most fun, unexpected.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it was great.
And they're performers, you know.
Yeah,
these guys are just
really good
so solid. So if you get a chance, please go see Jeffrey and the Pacemakers. Tell me about Two Trains Running.
At the Hattioo Theatre, The Hattioo has really committed themselves to trying to perform the entire August Wilson canon. Every year there's a different August Wilson play on their season. They've done Fences, The Piano Lesson, Joe Turner's done Come and Gone. This year they're doing Two Trains Running. August Wilson's mission was to write one play chronicling the African-American experience in every decade of the 20th century. So Two Trains Running is the play that he wrote looking at the 1960s. All of these plays are set in the Hill District in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And you think, well, it's the 60s, he's chronicling the African-American experience, this is probably going to be a civil rights play. It's going to revolve around the King marches or around Malcolm X or around you know, maybe Watts or just the social upheavals that are happening in the 60s. Wilson decided to do something more difficult and interesting with this play, and it's set in a an African-American-owned diner in a neighborhood, and it's really more just about the day-to-day lives of the regulars who come into this place. Hmm. It's sort of an anti-Cheers. Everybody knows your name, but you know you're not always sharing the best of times. You realize that just outside the door, there's a lot of upheaval happening. Factories are closing down. More and more black men are being taken off the streets by the police. You're beginning to watch a lot of the dynamics that will eventually tear our inner cities apart in the coming decades just start to fall into motion. It's a very talky play. It's not a traditional narrative, but the characters are fantastic. I would say rather than it being a story on its own, it's a play about people telling stories.
Oh, I like that. And it runs through the 26th.
It runs through the 26th. I will add very, very quickly that the Hattioo has big plans. You know, they're going to build this original $4 million theater in Open Square. It's very exciting. And I think that they do really incredible work. But at some point, they have got to step up and put someone in charge of their lighting, because it's been an afterthought pretty much from the day the theater opened. And nothing determines the way you see a play more than the lighting.
Well, lighting is just as much a character in a lot of plays as the characters.
As has been the case, this can make things choppier than it should be, sometimes more problematic than it should be. But there's some very good acting, and it's in some ways more fascinating than you might imagine, because August Wilson has taken this more difficult route.
Instead of the traditional,
this is what you think of when you think of the 60s. He said, this is what you don't think of when you think of the African-American experience in the 60s. And the gestalt is something else. It's much greater than the sum of its parts.
Well, Hattioo's pretty busy this week, too, because
yes.
the 11th and the 12th, they're teaming with the Memphis Symphony Orchestra and doing Romeo and Juliet. The 11th, they're performing at the Cannon Center, and then the 12th at GPAC. What do you know about the show, Chris?
Well, it's hard to remember, I think, sometimes because this has been such an ambitious little playhouse that they're only 6 years old.
I know. They're amazing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and one of the things that Eck and Dio really set his sights on from the beginning was to reach out into the other to the other performing arts communities and to do collaborations. It's only been a few years ago since he worked in conjunction with Opera Memphis. They produced Verdi's Macbeth. And they did Shakespeare.
And this one is with the
and
symphony.
And this is with the Memphis Symphony Orchestra. They're, the Memphis Symphony Orchestra under Mian Chen are going to perform excerpts from Prokofiev's Romeo and Juliet. And then the Hattioo will perform excerpts from
the
play.
And then soloist Gil Shahan is also performing...
Violinist.
Yes.
Yeah, and extraordinary violinist, in fact. This is sort of a prelude... Hattioo will eventually produce a full production of Romeo and Juliet that's going to be very different from what you're going to see.
I can't wait.
This time? Yeah, they're planning on like setting it, going back to the August Wilson discussion earlier, their Romeo and Juliet is going to be set in the middle of the civil rights movement, in the middle of the sanitation workers' strike.
Oh, wow. It's, that sounds awesome.
I got goosebumps on that one.
Yeah,
that
it really does sort of sound like the... where you want to put Romeo and Juliet in Memphis. So,
well, and you know, guys, I love my free things. I think this is really cool, and I love the title, Black Roots of Opera, Leontine Price Story, February the 14th at Hattioo. Soloist Allison Sanders will perform the works of Leontine Price, who's actually an American soprano who's from Laurel, Mississippi.
Laurel, Mississippi.
And that's a free show, so thank you guys for that. You know, that's pretty cool. And then, also in honor of Black History Month, the Bartlett Performing Arts Center is doing Ain't Misbehavin' on February the 11th. That will be at 8 o'clock.
Fats so, Waller, you can't,
it's, you can't go wrong,
it's
you know.
Such a great evening of songs. In fact, they just produced that not very long ago at the Hattioo. Mm-hmm. Great.
Denny, tell me about the Rhodes Distinguished Scholar lecture.
This is something that Rhodes does every year. Phi Beta Kappa sponsors a distinguished scholar from anywhere in the world to come and work with the university students, and then they do this free lecture that's open to the public. And this year, I think it's really good, and it sort of is a nod to the food community and the sort of the urban garden movement here in Memphis. Sir Peter Crane, who is currently the dean of the School of Forestry and Environmental Studies at Yale, he was the director of the Royal Botanic Gardens.
Very
cool.
Yeah. Oh, that's so way cool.
He's got some credentials.
Yeah, and he's talking about the future of plants, diversity, conservation, and sustainability. Love that.
Which sounds very cerebral, but he's going to be talking about seeds. So if you have a garden and are interested in finding out what type of seeds are good to plant that are good for the sustainability of that type of a plant, like a good tomato to grow that's not going to be invasive, this is the type of talks that you want to go to.
Know your soil, know your area, know your family, what you like, and know how to produce that.
Exactly. He was one of the founders of the Millennium Seed Project.
Oh, that is such a cool thing. Yeah, have you heard about it?
Really
no.
Cool.
It's like in Iceland or...
Yeah, they went around and they're trying to collect seeds from every single species in the world.
That's
so that
incredible.
There will always, so we won't ever lose anything ever
and
again.
Wasn't somebody from Memphis involved with that as well?
I think somebody from Memphis
is actually involved in it. Yeah. So they went and dug a hole in the ice and have all these seeds there.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, isn't that cool?
That's really
I love
cool.
that.
It's really neat. So check it out. It's going to be on the campus at Rhodes on March 1st. And it's free.
And it's free. So tell me about the Vagina Monologues that are coming up.
That's right. It's this weekend. It starts tonight. So it's February 9th through the 11th. It's the show's at 7:30 each night at Circuit Playhouse. But the doors open at 6, and you do want to get there early. It's number one because it's general admission seating, but also because there's going to be drinks. There's going to be a raffle with tons of local businesses have donated for this. I mean, every restaurant you can think of, gift certificates, all kinds of cool things, very Memphis-centric.
And now the monologues are, this was a Broadway play.
I don't know that it was ever
Wasn't
on Broadway.
It was off Broadway.
Off Broadway. But yeah, Eve Ensler, the playwright, did perform it as a one-woman show initially, and then it was expanded. Some people may have seen an HBO special that was very, very popular. It's about 15 years old now. The play, you know, it's important to note for anyone who has seen it, the play is different every year. There are new monologues, and because this play is so much about advocacy, there's a different cause, which we call the Spotlight Campaign, each year, and so a new monologue comes along with that as well, and it is a different experience every time, and there's different women, it's kind of different perspectives from that way as well.
And you know, it's known as the V-Day monologue, so was it partnered with Valentine's Day because of any particular reason? Do you know?
Chris? The relationship has grown, but the national, or actually rather international organization that sort of supports all of Eve's efforts and that she founded is called V-Day. And they say that the V stands for Valentine's Victory and Vagina, of course. Well, so, you know, it's a relationship that's been growing. But now V season actually spans. People perform this play all over the world, anywhere from January to April.
And don't feel like you have to write any of this stuff down. You can go to our website at wkno.org/localcolor. And we will have links to everything, including the site where you can get tickets for
Absolutely.
All of the events and addresses and dates and times and everything. Tell me about Next to Normal, Chris.
Well, it's Valentine's Day, and everyone likes a good love story. Next to Normal is...
Not that?
Well, you know, in some ways it is... one of the more profound love stories you're likely to see. It's difficult. It's not going to be for everybody. The show was just about to open the last time I was on and gave everybody a little bit of a heads up about it. I've seen it now, and it's powerful stuff. It's a play about a family that's completely a play, a musical, an award-winning Broadway musical about a family that's torn apart by mental illness. And there's choreography, but there's nothing that we would ever describe as dancing. There's humor along the way, but there's nothing you would describe as jokes. There's absolutely nothing musical theater about this show except for the fact that it's full of songs. And you really see that this is something that, you know, that love can't always conquer. It parallels the dissolution of a marriage between the Goodman family and also the blossoming of their daughter, who may or may not also have some problems in her future, and the young man who has determined he's going to stand by her no matter what. There's a whole lot of love in this show, but also just an amazing amount of heartbreak. And I want to see it again because I saw it on a preview night performance, and the theater was empty, and it was just a handful of invited people. I want to see the show with a full house because the amount of energy and emotion that pours out of that stage, off of that stage, I know is going to be very different when there's something there to reflect it.
And this is at Playhouse on the Square?
This is a Playhouse on the Square, and it's really an unusual piece of musical theater, and I can't, it's not going to be everyone's cup of tea, but I can't recommend it more highly.
Is this the same kind of emotion that you were talking about, August of Osage County, or?
Well, you know, it's a very different kind of show. And the other thing is the main actors, David Foster and Lee Bray Nichols, they are really emotionally available performers, just as actors. But they're also these big, gutsy singers. And when you get songs like I Miss the Mountains, I Miss the Mountains is Diana Goodman, the character who suffers from mental illness, actually confronting the fact that the antidepressants that she takes, it may keep her more together, but as it crushes all of the bad stuff, it also takes away the sort of blissful manic highs where she felt like she could do everything under the sun. And, you know, it's the moment where she really decides that she's going to give up her medicine and plunge back into illness. It's about a family that survived the death of a child, and they were able to keep the family unit together under a circumstance where most families fall apart anyway, with this extra added difficulty.
Well, this sounds like something that...
And there's an emergence of two young performers in this, too. Corbin... I'm going to forget Corbin's last name. I think it's Williams, Corbin Wilson. Kelsey Hopkins, who play the younger couple. The show is really about the husband and wife, as their marriage falls apart. But they are so watching their innocence shatter is such a powerful thing that it almost upends the play. It almost becomes about them. Really great performances by the young actors.
Well, that sounds really interesting.
Yeah.
Now onto something completely different. Have you guys heard of Mark Neiser in 3D? He's performing at Buckman Performing Arts Center. This guy is a professional juggler. So going from one extreme to the other.
Does 3D mean that he's throwing them
I don't
at your
know,
face?
Because
I have so many
Because listen,
about that.
He juggles lit propane tanks.
I
so
don't
hopefully
want that in 3D.
Not.
Yeah.
No,
so,
I'm okay
he
with that.
He sounds like a one man brother's Karamazov. I mean, kind
and
of.
And this is comedy. And I'm going, okay, if it's in 3D, that's like coming toward you and lit propane tanks juggling and it's funny and it's coming toward my hair. You know, anyway. it could be really funny. But he's
the
performing.
Nice and innocent. There's
it
not
is.
A whole lot of room. Nice and intimate.
I think they're in it.
Sure.
But that will be Friday the 10th at 7 at the Buckman. Okay, this is where I'm taking my husband for Valentine's Day. I'm taking my husband to the Million Dollar Quartet. So go, Chris. Tell us about the Million Dollar Quartet. I'm excited about this one.
Well, it's a Tony-winning Broadway play about the one and only occasion when Johnny Cash, Elvis Presley, Jerry Lee Lewis, and Carl Perkins were all gathered together.
Where?
In Sun Studios. And, you know, Cowboy Jack Clement happened to be sharp enough to think maybe I should turn on the recording equipment. And so there's this wonderful document of it. You can't really hear Johnny Cash in that document anywhere, but they swear he was there. And
his spirit was all over the place.
In this show, they find some songs for him to sing. And it's you want to talk about Valentine's? Okay. Some people may love Memphis the Musical, and as a piece of musical theater, this is not nearly as ambitious. But you want to talk about a Valentine. This show is a Valentine to Memphis, and especially to Sam Phillips, who, more than any of the musical talents, is really the heart of this show. And I also want to assure everyone else something else, because I know how Memphis can be about going to see plays that other people from somewhere else have written about
us.
Absolutely.
The music has been handled very nicely, and here's why. It was arranged by a guy named Chuck Mead. Does that name ring a bell to anybody? Chuck Mead, you may not recognize his name, but you probably have heard of his band, BR549.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. He's an Oklahoma-born Nashville cat who has played traditional honky-tonk for, how long have they been? 20 years
at least.
And he may be from Nashville, but he can hold forth with the best of them on the evolution of Gus's Fried Chicken. He can quote Sam Phillips. He cares,
so he's been to Memphis a couple of times.
He cares more about American roots music than
geography.
Yes, than just about anything else. And he was a really controversial choice because he didn't read music. You can't be our music arranger. You don't read music. What he did know how to do was produce a record. So the original casts of Million Dollar Quartet, he got them together and he treated them like a bar band that was getting ready to produce a record. They jammed.
Which that's
they
the Memphis
played.
Way to do it.
Absolutely. That's. I interviewed Chuck this week, and there's an excerpt from it in this week's flyer, and he was great. And one of the lines was, "You can't write down blue suede shoes. I mean, you can, but." And so, to this day, just like any touring band, you're going to fall into certain grooves and rhythms night after night. To this day, in the performances, because they are performed live by the actors who are playing Jerry Lee Lewis and Johnny Cash, there's still a little bit of an element of improvisation. There's still a little bit of spontaneity
Good.
In
I
life.
I think, too, with this being in Memphis, similar to Memphis the Musical, there's going to be such an energy from the performers.
Mm-hmm. I think so, too.
They're having their cast party at Sun Studios.
Oh, yeah.
These
That's
guys
awesome.
Are going to just be on fire, I think.
Yeah, I think so, too. And what a year for Memphis. My goodness, Memphis the Musical and now this. I mean, this is, I'm really excited.
Well, and when all this was happening in New York, I mean, there was a time when, you know, Million Dollar Quartet and Memphis were both on Broadway. Voices of the South was off Broadway with Sister Myotis' Bible Camp. Katori Hall was preparing, you know, who's, you know, from Memphis, a Memphis City Schools graduate. She was, you know, preparing to open her original script on Broadway, The Mountaintop. It was, you know, these last couple of years, Memphis has had a very big presence.
It's good.
On Broadway.
It's about time.
Yeah.
You know, thank goodness. Okay. Muddy's Bakery is so sinful. I love them so much. It's wrong. How can a cupcake be so good?
So good. They're amazing.
Yes, Kat works some magic over there, doesn't
she? Oh, my goodness. And tell me about the competition. Not a competition. Well, I guess
they are,
a competition.
It is. They're having a competition. First of all, you can pre-order your pies and cupcakes from Muddy's. And if you haven't had her pies...
I have not.
They are almost
they're so good.
If not better than her cupcakes.
You I don't know if I can. That. I don't know.
It's insane.
They're
it's
so
insane.
Good.
You shouldn't have said that.
But right
now, I'm going to have to go.
But right now, they're doing a contest through February 14th to guess how many cupcakes they'll sell from the bakery case on Valentine's Day. There's no limit to the submissions. You can go in every day and guess. And then if you win, you will receive a free dozen cupcakes of your choice and a cherry pie.
I'm definitely going.
So I think
and a cherry pie.
And a cherry pie.
So let me tell
Chris.
You.
Yes.
I can't eat it anyway.
But it is so good.
If you
good.
Win, you can give it to me. How about that?
But I do love cherry pie.
I do too.
Maybe I could just scrape out the filling.
You could. Just take a straw and suck the filling out. How about
exactly.
that?
Exactly.
Well, I want you guys to know that Lady Antebellum is coming to the Snowden Grove Amphitheater. That show is June the 28th, but tickets are right now on sale. And also, Trace Atkins is playing at the Orpheum. That will be May the 12th, and tickets are now on sale. So please go and get your tickets. And I want to say happy Valentine's Day to you guys. Denny, my
I have
sweet
some treats
angel.
For you guys. These are yeah. from local chocolatier.
Enjoy your local color.
Yum.
Now, where are they located?
Oh, God, white
you
chocolate.
You can buy them
Tell
at
me now.
Tally Shop.
Oh, my goodness. I'm so excited. I love chocolate.